I enjoyed yesterday afternoon dropping in on a couple of the workshops, and I enjoyed it for a number of reasons, but one was that it helped me understand who was here, and so it caused me to go away and rethink everything that I was going to say today. I'll still probably offend everyone, because with three separate groups of interest and levels of understanding and areas of understanding and so on, you're going to get something wrong for everyone at some point. And I may also offend you, because I believe that things should be said as simply as you possibly can. In the Design Museum in London, in the old building, not the new one, they painted on the wall a quote from Bruno Munari, the Italian designer, who said, design is simplifying, not complicating. And I think, you know, when we're faced with the complexity of the world, there are essentially two sorts of approaches. My wonderful professor, Gordon Pask, had one approach, which was to grab everything and keep shoveling it in, and to collect everything and then say he'd got everything. And one of the reasons that Gordon and I got on so well is that we had such different styles, we didn't really understand each other. And so my approach is to try to strip it down, and I'll really be happy when there is nothing to say about nothing. And that's another way of doing everything. So I may appear to oversimplify. This is intentional and possibly offensive. Good. I noticed that there seem to be more people here who use the word systems than cybernetics. Although yesterday there were a lot of people using the word cybernetics, it was really nice. I felt cozy and at home. But I thought that one of the things I should do is try to make a little difference between cybernetics and systems, or see if there is one. And then I should say a few words about cybernetics, since systems is the word that is used in the title here and used, I think, by the majority of people here. And then I would say a few words about design, because I'm sure that each of us means something different by it. So before I try to say that design and cybernetics are really the same thing, which is what I'll end up doing in a sort of limited way, before I say that, I'd really better explain to you what I understand design to be in as far as I can, because it won't be the same as many of you think. So it was always my intention to do this without slides. Carl Bass, who is the CEO of Autodesk, was asked why he never used slides. And he said, because if I use slides, you look at the eye candy and you don't listen to what I'm saying. So I think slides, PowerPoints and so on are actually mostly very destructive and very distracting. And they stop you from improvising. They absolutely pre-program everything. It's very difficult to escape from their plodding continuity. I rather like an Australian speechwriter called Don Watson, who wrote a book called Weasel Words, 2004. This is a wonderful book of cliches from management jargon and such like. And in it he has both bullet point and PowerPoint. And he says about PowerPoint, PowerPoint is a medium for presenting holiday snaps and for presenting assertions as if they were arguments. So both of which seem to me to be true. But that's not to say everyone does this. So I'm sure that each one of you is amongst the wonderful team of exceptional people. And I know that some of you make slides that are so stunningly beautiful that it's worth having the eye candy regardless of their excellence. So. Okay. So that's enough preliminary. There are these two words, aren't there? Cybernetics and systems. And if you belong, if you go to the world of meetings of systems groups and cybernetics groups, you'll find that they're very antagonistic very often. I've spent the last 6 years with the American Society for Cybernetics buddying up to the International Society for Systems Science. We used to feel enormously threatened by each other. We used to think that each was trying to take over the other. And it's not necessary to behave like that. It's a sort of juvenile behavior. So I would like to look at these two words just briefly and try to find out whether it matters that there are two words or not. Cybernetics, in its modern usage, came about in 1948. A man called Norbert Wiener published a book called Cybernetics, or Communication and Control in the Animal and the Machine. About 7 years later, he published the second edition of a book called The Human Use of Human Beings, which is actually the book he should have published first. And an enormous amount of the misunderstanding about cybernetics and systems would not have happened if Wiener had published that book first. Cybernetics is a mathematical, technical book which makes cybernetics look like an engineering subject. Human use of human beings shows that it's a way of thinking and a way of being in the world, which is a quite different sort of proposition. So Wiener was sort of at fault there. Nevertheless, he published this book, and then a year later, Ludwig von Bertalanffy published a book called General Systems Theory, 1949. I don't think there's anything very particular in these dates, but a lot of the argument about cybernetics or systems depends on people saying, we were first, you were first, you weren't, go away, horrible, you're stealing my stuff. Well, actually, both of them have been around for a very long time. Cybernetics goes back to Aristotle, who used the word, so that's 2,500 years or so. And Aristotle, being Greek, used the Greek word in the Greek way, meaning helmsman or steersman. That is, the person who sits at the back of the boat and gets it to the right place. System is, if I talk about cybernetics, I end up talking about cybernetic systems. So the two go together in that sort of sense. I think there is a difference between them. I think cybernetics tends to be more abstract, and systems tends to be more pragmatic. But that doesn't seem to me to be a reason for squabbling. And indeed, a lot of the people, at least in cybernetics, said it really doesn't matter which word you use. So I'm going to use the word cybernetics where you use the word systems, and you're going to use the word system where I use the word cybernetics. And we're going to mean more or less the same thing. If there is a difference, I think the difference is there's the one of abstract versus pragmatic or something like that. And there is, I think, a second useful difference, which it's a differentiation made by a man called Jean-François, a Belgian who lives in Argentina, who composed an extraordinary international encyclopedia of cybernetics and systems. You know, it's one of those $500 books that your library can't afford, but it's a very extraordinary book. His position, and he's in a good position to have a position, is that cybernetics is the dynamic complement of systems. Yesterday there were a number of diagrams around, very typical sort of systems diagrams, with boxes here and here and here and here, and arrows connecting, you know? Typical systems thing. And Francois would say systems people are interested in the boxes and cybernetics people are interested in the arrows. Yeah? And that's quite possibly it. Good. Well, that's got that out of the way, I think. Excellent. I've also got my cards out of order. I I imagine that all of you ride a bicycle, drive a car, or steer a sailing boat. Would that be fair? All of you do something like that. Yeah. And I imagine that you've done something like this. You've looked straight ahead and said, I don't have to adjust the handlebars, I'm just going to go straight ahead. Or the steering wheel, or the tiller arm. You're just going to go straight ahead. And you're going to go straight down that road, and if you don't move anything, within about 100 or 200 metres, you're off the road. Yeah? If you don't adjust the tiller, you're no longer pointing to that lighthouse, but you're pointing to some fishing hut over there. Yeah? You all know this experience. Steering is a difficult thing to do. It's you can't just point something, because the world is full of surprises and errors and things that don't quite work as we think they do, that don't quite match the model we have of how the world is. Yeah? So when we steer, we don't just point somewhere and go. We all the time have ways of adjusting what we're doing. Yeah? We're all the time accommodating for little errors that come about for all sorts of reasons, and they're not really important, but I suppose most of all they come around because models of the world are not the world. So our imagination of how the world works is not how the world works. It's our imagination of it. I don't want to get into how does the world work, how do we know, that sort of thing. I'm trying to avoid that. So what cybernetics is based on, there's two very surprising things. First of all, it's based on error. Cybernetics is the subject that says we accept that error is endemic. There is always error. The question is not to eradicate error, not how do we eradicate error, but how do we manage error? How do we live with error? Because there is always error. And of course, one of the ways we live with error is we turn it into opportunity. That's a really good way of living with error. The other thing about cybernetics is that it's responsive. Cybernetics doesn't initiate. It responds to situations we find ourselves in. So, I'm steering this path. I find that I'm no longer pointing where I thought I would be pointing because there's been a gust of wind or there's a little bit of funny stuff going on in the sea or whatever it is. Yeah? And I have to adjust. I respond to that change in situation and adjust, and we continue. Now, the form of this process, the name given to it usually is feedback. I don't happen to like the word feedback because it suggests that it's something very tiny that's going back to something that's sort of big and chunky. Yeah? I prefer the word circularity, because cybernetic systems are not systems that are interested in energy. They're interested in information. And Ross Ashby, who was one of the great founding fathers of cybernetics and wrote what is still the best introductory book to the subject, astonishing introduction to cybernetics from 1956 or something. And he reminds us in that book that cybernetic systems are not subject to the laws of physics, to energetics. They're subject to the laws of information. So they're concerned with messages. And what I get when I'm steering is I see that I'm going wrong and send a message to adjust the tiller. Yeah? So there's a circularity there. I want to go somewhere and I sense whether I'm still going there, and if I'm not, I adjust something and I'm going there again. Let me switch examples to another very common, very simple cybernetic system. The thermostat. We all know the thermostat, thank goodness for it. And look, there's one over there. You see that white thing there on the wall? I think that's probably a thermostat. Now, we all know the thermostat. You set it to a particular temperature. And when the room gets a bit cold, because we're in cold countries, aren't we? It turns on some central heating device, a furnace, some hot air, some warm water, whatever it is, bit of electricity, heating wires in the floor, however it's done. And the space in the room heats up until it exceeds the temperature that we have set. And then it turns things off. And that's clearly a circular system. There are two components. There's a switch on the wall, and there's a heat supply system. And one controls the other, doesn't it? So the switch, you'd all agree that the switch controls the furnace and what have you. And you'd actually be wrong to agree. You'd be wrong. Because you have to say to yourself, well, what is it that controls the switch? And the answer is the furnace providing the hot air or whatever, yeah? So the furnace heating the room. And that says that in a circular system, things like control are not, as we have thought of them, one thing controlling another. The control is caught by the interaction of the two components balancing each other. And each is the controller of the other. It's a very strange concept, this. You know, when I introduce it to people, they're very shocked. What do you mean? The furnace is, that switch is controlling things. And I've always wondered why we position things in this sort of power relationship, this linear thing about control. And someone suggested to me it was actually because we think of the energy. And that's a reason I don't like to use feedback as the word, but use circularity, because feedback sort of has that energy notion in it. Okay, now, let me suggest that we change a word here. And instead of talking about the switch controlling, let me talk about the switch observing. Observing is also a word I'm trying to get rid of at the moment, but I'll use it because everyone knows it. And what the switch does is it observes the environment. Yeah? You'd probably think that was okay. Yes, in the scientific sense, it observes the environment. You might find it hard to think of the furnace observing the environment, but it sort of does. But what I think is interesting is that in a circular system, we're talking not about one thing observing the other, but both observing each other. Right? Now, I'd like you to think of this system. Here's my switch and here's my furnace. Yeah. I'd like to shrink these down, put a box around them and treat them as one. So there we are. That's the whole of this. It's just all gone in there. And I'd like to ask you this question. Here I am as an observer, and I want to observe this thing, which happens to be a thermostatic system, which we've been talking about. Now, this thermostatic system is observing circularly. Yeah? What I want to know is, how should I observe this system? Well, the traditional way would be I'd sort of stand above it and look at it, not touch it, of course, have no effect on it, of course, be completely objective and repeatable, of course, be a non-observer, of course. And I'd do this and look down on this thing and record what happened here. Well, there may be something a bit silly in that position in thinking you can do that. But science has managed to do it very, very effectively, and every one of us who got here depended on science doing this and what it gave us to enable us to get here. So, you know, it's not a thing to be dismissive of. And it's done it, you know, for as long as there's been science, but let's just pretend it's 400 years. Now, in 1968, Margaret Mead, who's an anthropologist, she's, if you don't know who Mead was, look her up, but one of the things that she did was she was the first anthropologist to put into practice the notion that the observer of a group of people should not stand aside and be the traditional scientific observer, but should engage with those people in order to find out how they lived and what their values were and so on. In other words, you should consult them and be part of the life. And she talked to the American Society for Cybernetics and said, how about you guys are consistent? How about you've learned certain things you call cybernetics? How about you apply those to yourself? How about, as a society, you study societies, you tell societies how they ought to be shaped, you've got ideals and so on, how about you apply it to yourselves? We never did. I spent the last 6 years trying to get us to apply a bit more cybernetics to our own society. So it wasn't the first time she'd said this either. So it fell on deaf ears, but it didn't quite fall on deaf ears. What she was asking was that cybernetics behaved in a way that was somehow consistent with itself, a self-consistency. Now let's go back. Here is my thermostatic system. It's got a switch and a heat supply, and they're communicating in a circularity like that. And I've switched the word control to observe, just for convenience. Here I am observing it from above. Now, isn't there an inconsistency in here? Isn't my observation in here circular, and yet I'm trying to stand above this and pretend I haven't learnt about circular systems? So what Mead said was, okay, how about we treat this in the same way as we treat this? How about this observer is in a circular relationship with what it's examining? So now you have the same form of system. You've got two items in a circle in here. I've put a box around them and treat them as one. Here's another observer, and now these two are in the same sort of circle. And that was the origin of what is called second order cybernetics, which is the attempt to bring cybernetics into a form of consistency, but also to recognize that the observer is not optional, but to imagine. Heinz von Förster, who is credited with having originated second order cybernetics, said objectivity is a subject's delusion that observing can be done without him or herself. Let me move on to design. This is all about the magic number 2. The word design is extremely difficult because it has very many meanings. One of the meanings that perhaps some of you don't know is the meaning when we say he had designs on her, meaning he wanted to get her into bed. Perfectly ordinary English. It may not be acceptable, but it's perfectly normal. I have to be very careful here. Forgive me, I'm just an Englishman, and I'm not even that. The Dutch and Germans didn't really have words for design, and they invented them. And I love the Dutch formgeving, giving form to things. The Germans used the word Gestalt, Gestaltung. And I love that too, because it's about holes. It's about making complete. Isn't that, this sort of thing, that's wonderful. For the English, the word design came into English in about 1480, according to Eduardo Cortreal. And it came in two forms, both from Italian. One was designare and one is disegnare. By the way, I discovered I gave what I called an exaugural lecture at UCL. So I left it so long to give my professorial inaugural lecture that I was just about to leave. So exaugural seemed like a better word. I wanted to talk about the way in which human beings find patterns. And I phoned up our professor of Latin and said, how, you know, Homo sapiens, all this sort of thing, how would you translate man the designer? No, man the pattern finder. She thought a moment and said, Homo designans. Isn't that nice? Pattern finding is designing in Latin. So. So there are these two words, designare and disegnare. One means drawing, one means designating. And they came into English at the same time and got sort of confused. So that's the first two. The second two is that the word design is a noun and a verb. And we get very confused by this. I think for people who do designing, designing is a verb. And for people who assess designing, which is most researchers, design is a noun. And we're not talking about the same thing. Yeah? So I would throw away most design researchers. Don't tell anyone. I'm supposed to be a professor on it, somehow. I think that it's really important we understand this, that we get confused about whether we're talking about a means of doing something, a way of behaving, an activity, or whether we're talking about the outcome of that activity. And a lot, for me, a lot of design research is about assessing the outcome of a design activity. And the problem for me is that being told it's not good or not good enough, I know that. I'm a designer. That's what I know. The world I live in is the world of not being right but being good enough, I hope. Which of course is very optimistic because it always leaves room for improvement. Yeah. So it's not about perfection. But if I'm told it's not perfect, what I want to know is how do I make it more perfect? That's the thing that I want as a designer. I don't want to be told it's not quite right, I know that. What I want to know is how to make it better. And that's what most design research doesn't tell me at all. That just disappoints me. The third pair I want to talk about is the art school and the engineering university. We have in the UK two different traditions that started, let's say, around about 1850. This is a completely incorrect date, but then I'm a designer, so it's good enough for what I want. There are two quite different approaches and quite different traditions as to how you act in the world and so on. And I think that the art school approach is interested in novelty and accepts the notion of good enough and is concerned with practice. And the university approach gives us a research tradition, and a very good one, and is concerned with efficiency and bestness. These are quite different approaches. And we tend to have people battling and saying, well, I'm the only one who's right. I think historically it's the art school lot who are right, which is the lot I happen to sort of sit with. That's where I feel comfortable. We have these two different ways, and they involve very different aspirations and ways of thinking. And I think that we need to keep this at least in mind. I don't think we will ever resolve the difference, and I don't think we have to. What we have to do is, just as the cyberneticians have to be nice about systems and the systematists have to be nice about cybernetics, so the university engineer designers have to be nice about the art school designers, and the art school designers have to be nice about the university engineering designers. Yeah? We have to learn, each has a strength, each has something to give us. The last thing I want to say in this sort of sense about design is that for me, the earliest definition I know of design, in the Western world at least, remains the best. And it is Vitruvius's. Vitruvius, in his 10 books on architecture, which didn't mean buildings, meant things like water clocks, and viaducts, and all sorts of things. So it didn't. It's much more about design than about architecture as we know it, as a particular form of designing. Incidentally, at the RCA, until I joined the staff of Innovation Design Engineering when they got their master's students for each year, they divided them into two categories, designers and non-designers. And non-designers, well, because we take a lot of non-designers and knock them into design shape pretty fast. But the non-designers were people from medicine. We had someone who was a quantum gravity physicist. So we have all sorts of weird people. And until I got there, architects were in the non-designers. And I looked at the guys and said, we were designing 8,000 years before you were. Stop being silly. anyway. So Vitruvius gave us three elements. The first is thermitas, which means being well constructed, being well made. The second was utilitas, functional, serving its purpose. And the last was venustas, which gets translated into English as delight, which I think is a very nice word, much better than beauty or something like that. And I think that we're not designing unless we have delight. I think that it's delight which is the thing which is difficult and which brings the difference between being a human and being a machine. And while I'm very interested in machines which bring liberty to us, which I think they can do, I'm not at all interested in humans who are being machines unless they're in some really nice play. Yeah. So, for me, there's one extraneous thing about design which I consider to be enormously important, and it is this, that design, you know how it is we are preserving every bug we can find in the Amazon, yeah? And you know that we might tread on something and it was the last of that type, and it might at some stage in the future be helpful to us and give us a medicine or something. It is a major concern. I find it strange that we're not interested in different ways of thinking. That we have a tendency to want to preserve only one way of thinking. And for me, one of the things which is enormously important about design is design gives us a different way of looking at and solving the things we call problems. And for that reason alone, it's enormously important. It happens that it works. It happens that it does all sorts of wonderful things. But even if it didn't, it would be worth preserving. So I just slipped that in because I think it's important that we understand that we should be valuing design in this way. Okay. I'm going to talk, in fact, about a conversation. And conversation is the bridge between cybernetics and design. Just think about a conversation for a moment. You know, a minimal conversation is sort of between two people, isn't it? It's difficult to imagine it between one person. Actually, you can, and I'll do that in a moment. But conversations are between two people. You know, just think of going down to the pub one evening, to the cafe. So we're not using much in the way of mind-altering drugs, I think that sort. And we chat with someone, and at the end of the evening, we're talking about something. We can't even remember anything about how we got there. How did I start here? How did we end up here? Conversation has an extraordinary sort of slippage in it. Now, conversation is a way of being with someone else, of communicating, in which we don't actually have to claim we understand the same thing. It's very difficult, this question of where meaning lies and what understanding is and whether words have meanings and so on. But for me, without sort of dressing up an argument on this, meaning is in my head and your head, and what's in your head and what's in my head is completely different. They're absolutely unavailable to each other. So there, and just think about it. If you wish to communicate unequivocally and unambiguously using verbal language, what you do is you join the military and you are bullied for 3 months to become an automaton which responds absolutely and immediately and mechanically to certain command words. You just do what you're told. Yeah? It takes 3 months to knock the individuality out of us, turn us into that sort of a machine. So I see this as being an indication that language can't work as a code without us doing a lot of work on it. And if it doesn't work as a code, and if the meaning isn't in the words but is made by the listener, then how do we communicate? Well, we have developed this thing called a conversation in which one of us says something and the other one listens and then says something in response. It might be, you know, I might say tree, and you might say back to me, arbor. Yeah? And I'd say, yeah, that's about the right sort of idea. But we, and it says we can go on in parallel without actually knowing what the other thinks, but knowing that the other's response to us gives us something that is close enough in our understanding to what we first said that we can say, yeah, they understand. And so we have this sort of slippery thing that moves along like this. Parallel and sometimes falling apart. Sometimes you say, just stop, I can't understand you. We have all the time when in a conversation, a meta-conversation going on, which is a commentary on the conversation. And we have a sort of substratum, which is the thing the conversation's about. And we can start talking, and instead of the substratum being hidden there, we can say, let's talk about what this conversation is about. And go down, and go up to talk about how it is we're thinking the conversation's going, and so on. So there are three levels, and yeah. Now, what's interesting about a conversation then is that we assume two different sets of understandings, and we assume that we can participate in this, be one of the people with one of the sets of understandings, and that. What we get from someone else is not what we offered, but something which is their version, or what we hope is their version of it. Yeah? And that's always going to be a little bit different. Always going to be a little bit different. And that's why you can't have a conversation when you just parrot each other. So if you just imitate someone back, have you ever tried having a conversation like that? Yeah, you sort of do it as a kid, don't you? And kids will do it to you. There was a lady with a baby here, so, and someone back there, but there's also a pram here. You wait. So, now, a conversation is actually a circular activity. It involves me saying something, and you saying something, and me saying something, and you saying something. Sometimes it involves me saying, hold on, let's go back, do I understand this, and so on. But essentially it's a circular activity like this. Yeah. And it has two participants. Tick, tock, tick, tock, tick, tock. Fine. How about if you had a conversation with yourself? How would you do that? Okay. It's too many people to ask the audience a question. That's why I didn't ask you to actually do that steering thing. Okay. Well, how many of you think you are always only the same one person? Can we have sort of heads nodding? And, you know, maybe we can get confused here because half of you will be Greek and be doing it the other way around. Yes, absolutely. There was a wonderful ad on TV with a guy being acting furious and being terribly nice to a hairdresser. So anyway, sorry. I just had this image. So. When we go home, we're a different person than when we're at work. We have more than one way of being in all of us. And so we can hold a conversation with ourselves by recognizing that there is more than one persona within us. This isn't a matter of split brain or schizophrenia or anything of that sort. It's just simply how we are in the world. We're not one person. We are many people, and we fit together. A lot of people had said this in different ways. My cybernetics professor. And he was also the person who spent a lot of time formulating how conversation works. Okay. I can also do it in this way. I can have a piece of paper and I can make a mark and go away and come back and look at it later. And you know what happens when you've drawn something and you come back and look at it later? Is it looks different than you thought you'd drawn it. Yeah? So in a sense, the piece of paper is having a conversation with you, and you're taking two roles, the person who draws, the person who looks, the person who draws, the person who looks. For me, this activity, this thing of holding a conversation with yourself, usually through paper and pencil, is what is at the center of designing. This, for me, is the act that makes design design. This, without this, you're not doing design, you're doing problem solving. And the thing which is magical about this is exactly what's magical about the conversation where you end up talking about something you've no idea how you came to be talking about it, you know, at the end of the evening. What's a miracle is that you can make a mark on a piece of paper and see it differently than you meant it. Or sometimes you don't know what you're doing. Your hand's just moving, you know. And you come back and you look. You say, oh, what would happen if? And now you're designing. And this is, for me, at least a major source of novelty in designing. That because there is always this difference between persona, between marking and viewing, between two people, because there's always this difference, there's always this potential not to look at it as an error, but to look at it as an opportunity. And I think that what designers do is they make errors that are opportunities. They hold conversations with themselves. And it is through this that they manage to do something which is quite, quite magical, which is to find the new. And it's through this that designers solve problems, but they don't. What designers do is they go on a sort of wander through the forest and find a beautiful place to sit down and say, that's why I went on this walk today. It's that sort of thing, that you find something, you say, that's it. It doesn't mean that you're not dealing with the functional aspect of things. It doesn't mean that you're not dealing with well-madeness. It just means that you leave room for the delight for yourself of making something that you hadn't expected, and for the delight that this can bring others. And this form of activity is entirely cybernetic. And that's why I say that cybernetics and design are opposite sides of the same coin. At least my cybernetics and my design are. And I hope that for some of you, now your cybernetics and your design are. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This is wonderful.